Hi, my name's Jim Meuninck. 20 years ago, Dr. Jim Duke and I put together a video called Edible Wild Plants. Now, here's the sequel. The premise of this program is that you are a plant with wheels. That is, you either eat plants or you eat animals that eat plants. Therefore, all your chemistry is made up from plant chemistry. A single plant may have over 10,000 unique chemicals, some of which nurture the plant and others that protect it. When you eat a plant, your body uses both this nurturing chemistry and this protective chemistry. Let's discover how chemicals from wild plants help us perform better and feel better. Eating edible wild plants that have a slightly bitter taste improves digestion and assimilation. It initiates the drip, drip, dripping of hydrochloric acid and digestive enzymes and kicks up peristalsis. One way to improve digestion is to add a few snippets of dandelion leaves to a salad. A decoction of dandelion root is a potent bitters that stimulates my entire digestive system. A decoction is used to capture chemistry from the tough, woody parts of plants, the roots, stems, bark, and seeds. A tea, commonly called an infusion, can be made in several ways. First, a hot infusion of a fresh herb. Mint provides a burst of energy, stimulates the mind, and clears the sinuses. Looks like I got me an elm. Anyway, infusions pull the chemistry from the soft parts of a plant. The leaves, the buds, and the flowers. I prefer a cold infusion. A cold infusion captures all the aromatic compounds, the essential oils, and provides robust flavor. To make an excellent cold infusion, stuff a liter jug with members of the mint family, bee balm, peppermint, aquatic mint, lemon balm, or balm melissa. Cover the fresh herbs with potable water. Add lemon or lime juice, the juice from about a half fruit to each liter. Chill in the refrigerator for 6 hours. Pour off this cold infusion and enjoy better health. Decoctions and infusions are two effective ways to get the benefits of wild plants in your diet. But hang on, we're just getting started. Edible wild plants are nutrient dense, potent, and viable. They are untampered with by human hands. They contain all the chemicals we co-evolved with. For hundreds of thousands of years, they have been our food and our medicine. The edible wild plants identified in this program are open-pollinated, abundant, and contain the spectrum of flavors you enjoy. And best of all, they're free. Everyone likes to save money, and when something is free, that's the best. Let me show you how I saved money this week by eating edible wild plants. This is my lending tree in the bank of the woods. Wow, I'm rich. Okay, to help you get healthy and wealthy, I have to do something very difficult for me. Get organized. What comes first? For me, it's a healthy breakfast. Guanzontles is a Native American dish originating in Mexico. To make guanzontles, clip a fistful of flour and seed heads from lamb's quarters. Then steam the clippings for 2 minutes. Next, flop the flour heads in a couple of whipped eggs. Sauté over medium heat until golden. Serve with wild berries and salsa, with a garnish of pumpkin flowers, nasturtiums, and borage blossoms. Guanzontles are fun to eat. You just strip the stems, the flowers, and the seeds between your teeth and chew. Delicious. I discovered this next recipe in a cave under a waterfall. To make a Paleolithic waffle, use Stone Age ingredients. Add to the pancake flour, cattail pollen, and wild rice. Then stir in cranberries and pine nuts. Garnish with edible flowers and drench with maple syrup. The Paleolithic waffle will have your friends grunting for joy. Another once-a-week favorite is my Cro-Magnon omelet. Enter into the eggs what's available. Here's one with cattail pollen, peppers, wild leeks, watercress, and yucca blossoms. I like mushrooms with eggs. Big puffballs are easy to identify, but for optimum flavor, make certain the inner flesh has not gone to spores. This one is too far gone to enjoy. Large puffballs are best breaded and fried. Smaller puffballs can be problematic. Always cut them in half. The meat should be solid, white. If there are gills present, then it is not a puffball and may be a toxic amanita. To improve a puffball's flavor, cut away the skin and expose the inner white flesh. Ingredients include pieces of puffball, stinging nettle, watercress, and wild leeks. garnished with salsa and grated Parmesan, Romano, or Asiago cheese. When you have a house full of mouths to feed, try the T-Rex frittata. Also called a tortilla española, I load this breakfast treat with watercress, peppers, fontina cheese, wild asparagus, mushrooms, dandelions, wild leeks, Jerusalem artichokes, plantain, horseradish, chickweed, and stinging nettle. Here's a variation and a solid tip. A frittata with whole wild asparagus, Jerusalem artichokes, and horseradish. After removing a frittata from the oven, set the pan in ice water. That stops the cooking and helps release the frittata from the pan. I have found morels in Oregon, Washington, Illinois, Michigan, New York. They pop up in the spring, typically in the Midwest during the last 2 weeks of April and the first 2 weeks of May. Cut morels open to pick away the bugs if there are any. When I don't have time to monkey around, I make the chimpanzee surprise. This breakfast beverage requires pawpaws. Blend a half cup of pawpaw fruit, one banana, and a teaspoon of grated ginger with 16 ounces of soy milk or rice dream. This is going to be a fall-only breakfast unless you freeze ample amounts of pawpaw for later use. When in a hurry, make nutritious and tasty jungleberry toast. Lather on your favorite jam, smother that in pawpaw, crush atop some blackberries and blueberries, and sprinkle with pine nuts. 1, 2, 3, and you're out of here. Person could live in here. I find myself using 12 plants, what I call a forager's dozen, over and over again. These plants are found just about everywhere. Here's the forager's dozen. Stinging nettle, woodland violets, watercress, wild leeks, cattails, daylilies, Jerusalem artichokes, yellow wood sorrel, purslane, dandelions, chickweed, and bee balm. These plants are covered in detail on this DVD and in my books, Basic Essentials of Edible Wild Plants and Medicinal Plants of North America. What's for lunch? I call it the dump truck pita. This pita pocket features elderflowers, yucca blossoms, yucca buds, daylily petals, and remember to pick daylily petals from their bitter reproductive organs before you eat them. In addition, I typically pop in what's available, plantain, chickweed, tomato, lettuce, and a thin slice of sweet potato. Saute the wild plants, assemble the mess, and slop it down. What's next? If sandwich, then soup. Here's piltdown stew.
What in the world is that?
Okay, I'm going to have to walk you through this one. It's all intuitive, and even so, sometimes it comes out kind of weird. I've got stinging nettle. Come on, dummy. We are waiting. It's French sorrel. French sorrel. Sorrel. I'm going to have to do this myself. First, make a decoction using horseradish, French sorrel, dandelion leaves, stinging nettle, the flowers, stems, seeds, and leaves, a clutch of basil, two onions, 9 or 10 wild leeks, and a sprig of epazote. Epazote is a relative of lamb's quarters that grows wild in the southwest in Mexico and in my garden. It is strong flavored, and a small amount, about a teaspoon's worth, is good in the broth I'm brewing. Push it all down with a pumpkin or whatever else is handy. Cover and simmer for at least 30 minutes. Pour off the broth. Discard all the plant material except the leeks and onions. I add about 2 tablespoons of stock to the decoction. It can be chicken, beef, or miso shiro, white miso. Use it as a broth to enrich soups and stews. It's mineral rich, earthy, sweet, and satisfying. Remember the horror film, Revenge of the Sardine? Well, here's the soup that killed the monster. For a base, use a pint of the piltdown stock we just made with a tablespoon of miso shiro. Add some cooked rice noodles like these, or a package of prepared noodles like this. The soup contains Jerusalem artichokes, a couple sprigs of stinging nettle, wild chives, and is accented with a grilled sardine. Ladle the hot miso and noodles over the wild vegetables. And christen this holy mackerel with sesame seed oil. Boy, oh boy, we're only halfway through the menu and I'm stuffed. So let's get some exercise. Let's run west and see what's going on. Along the way are millions of sunflowers with their edible seeds. Pineapple weed, Matricaria discoidea, flower heads are infused to make a relaxing pineapple-scented tea. Miner's lettuce, Claytonia perfoliata, is the glorious weed that saved the Gold Rush 49ers. Leaves and flowers are mixed in salads. Monarda fistulosa, bee balm, has oregano-flavored flowers and leaves. Use the florets in spaghetti sauce or sprinkle over pizza. A few milkweeds are edible, others are questionable. Stay away from milkweed until you know which is which and how to prepare them. Buckwheat of the Aragonum genus is found in the dry, open montane areas of the West. When the florets are infused in water, they make a bland drink, taken for centuries by Native Americans as a membrane-soothing tea. Arrowleaf balsam root, Balsamoriza sagittata, has edible leaves and shoots. Dig them in the spring before they emerge. Late season roots are difficult to dislodge. But spring roots can be roasted, peeled, and eaten. Bitter and unsatisfying. Where there are elk, there's elk thistle. The early spring shoots of elk thistle, Cerium scariosum, are edible. Strip away the spines, eat raw or in a salad. Tastes like celery. Roots may be roasted, peeled, and eaten. Bear grass, Xerophyllum tenax, has edible but stringy, tooth-cracking roots. Leave this for the elk and bears. Sitka valerian, Valeriana sitchensis, has odoriferous roots that can be stewed in soups, but is best used in decoction as a mildly sedative tea. Seeds are parched and eaten. Fireweeds of the Epilobium genus have edible leaves, and the young shoots are also edible. When cooked, they have the taste of asparagus. Flowers are edible too, as Mom Moose confirms. Gooseberry of the Ribes genus are found from coast to coast. I eat the buds, the flowers, and the fruit. Competition with other beasts often makes me a day late and a gooseberry short. Blackberries, blueberries, currants, and other berries are covered in the Tree, Shrubs, Nuts, and Berries program on this DVD, or in even greater detail at herbvideos.com. The Colombian tiger lily, Lilium colombianum, is too rare to be eaten. As we approach the coastal rainforest, we bump into Devil's Club, Oplopanax horridus. Young leaves may be eaten in soups and casseroles, but thorn scratches can cause a rash, and the seeds are toxic. Pipsissewa, Chymophila umbellata, leaves are infused in water to treat colds and influenza. Leaves and berries are edible, but the plant has been over-harvested and is becoming rare. Red alder, Ulnus rubra, is an abundant tree in the Northwest. Wood chips are used to smoke meats, and the smoke adds a wondrous flavor to salmon. Mountain ash, Sorbus sitchensis, has edible but very tart berries. See my mountain ash sweet tooth recipe in the trees and shrubs section of this DVD. When you are finally stopped by the Pacific, there's madrone. This arbutus is a coastal hardwood with edible berries, but not tasty edible berries. Native Americans used the bark to infuse a pink color to cook camas bulbs. Plantago maritima is a durable plantain clinging to the last edges of land. Their salty leaves are chopped into salads or cooked into stews. West Coast skunk cabbage, Lysochitin americanum, has huge leaves used by Native Americans to wrap salmon and other meats for pit cooking. Foodstuffs were buried and cooked under hot coals. Put the fish in there, wrap it up, roll it over, bury it. Subarboreal bunchberry provides an edible fruit. Dawdling along the water's edge, you might find beach peas, Lithyrus japonicus. Flowers and peas are edible, best steamed or in soup. I have them sprinkled over salads. Fresh young stems of sea asparagus, American glasswort, Salicornia genus, can be eaten raw or cooked or sauteed in butter. Kelp is as far as I go. Laminaria species and numerous other species of marine algae are eaten. A fresh or dried cup of kelp frond fortifies soups with minerals. Well, that's your trip west. Now for a warning. Remember, many edible wild plants are toxic and others are completely unsuitable to eat. The other two sections of this DVD have similar warnings and show some of the most dangerous varieties, such as false hellebore here and poison hemlock here. Remember, in the beginning, forage with an expert and never eat any plant without verifying its identity from several sources. Go to herb videos and visit the edible wild plant section for more information on poisonous plants, then link to the National Toxic Plant Database. Start feeding your intellect. Get into the field and forage carefully. Begin with common, easy to identify edible wild plants like dandelion leaves, plantain, stinging nettle, purslane, daylily blossoms, yellow wood sorrel, and evening primrose flowers. Add one or two new species every season, and before long, your supermarket bills will go down and your health will become more robust. Now let's get back to the guy in the canoe. To stoke your appetite for dinner, here are some quick and easy treats. First, olives stuffed with wild leeks. Here's how to make a kitty cracker. Why do I call it a kitty cracker? The cracker's name came from my cat Boots, who rubs scent on the flowers, imparting a distinctive taste and odor to this appetizer. Washing flowers before you eat them dampens the vileness of this treat. Wild plant ingredients include daylily buds, yucca buds, and yucca petals. Infuse the flower parts in hot water for 3 minutes. This softens the buds and petals. Then stir fry the buds for 2 more minutes. Spread hummus on a cracker, press the sauteed buds into the hummus, and garnish with cornflower florets and wild carrot blossoms. You'll need 1/4 cup of chopped tomatoes, 1/2 onion chop, 2 or 3 slices of jalapeno pepper, pickled or fresh, 1/4 cup of cilantro, and a like amount of watercress. Add 5 chopped leeks, 1 tablespoon of lime juice, and the avocado. Mince the ingredients, combine with the avocado, squeeze in the lime juice, salt and pepper to taste. Then blend all with the avocado. Use this handy instrument I invented, the one my spouse Jill refuses to recognize as a serious kitchen tool. Try a dollop on fresh dandelion leaf. Next, Jerusalem chips. Thank you. How about Jerusalem chips steeped in jalapeno pickling brine? Simmer artichokes in brine for 5 minutes. Transfer the chips and brine to a canning jar. Use chips on sandwiches, crostinis, and pizza. Here's a tip on how to rescue roadside flowers and move them to your garden. Get to know your local mower from the Road Commission. This guy murders edible wild plants. But if you engage him, tell him you are part of a plant rescue team, then he might even help you dig. Let's warm up before dinner with some Spanish tapas-style recipes. Wilderness crostini requires 4 or 5 whole wild leeks and a half dozen wild asparagus shoots, plus a quarter cup of lamb's quarters leaves, a half loaf of whole wheat bread, and a full-flavored cheese, like this elderberry wine cheese from Great Britain. A final dusting of Parmesan is optional. And a tablespoon of olive oil is used to sauté the greens. Lather mayo on the bread, then swoop on some pesto. This pesto recipe is half basil and half watercress. Chop, then sauté the vegetables. Spread the veggies on bread, smother the crostini in elderberry cheese, and bake at 325 degrees for about 6 minutes. Then brown and bubble the cheese for 1 minute under the broiler. This dish can be prepared ahead of time and frozen for later use, and the results are excellent. My wife Jill, she ordered me to get rid of all my old ties, to cut them up and use them for this purpose, to mark the asparagus. It wasn't easy for me to do. I drive by here in the winter, and this one here is from the high school prom. Anyway, I get to see them 2 or 3 times a year, and then in the spring, there they are laying on the ground. I can retrieve them and use them again and pick the asparagus shoots. But be careful when you're doing this. I thought I heard somebody. There's always people watching me do this. You know, they want to know where I get my asparagus, where I get my mushrooms. Jill says I'm paranoid. I'm not paranoid. They're out there. It's a conspiracy. The pumpkin blossoms are stuffed with, from left to right, top row, pepperoni slices, violet leaves, fresh basil, garden sorrel, then second row left to right, chopped and sauteed dryad saddle, a polypore mushroom. I find dryad saddle, polypore squamosus, in all 3 seasons, but it's only good fresh. It likes moist, damp areas and has these distinctive pores instead of gills. Tear the fresh mushroom and the unmistakable odor of watermelon is released from the fungus. To continue, here's watercress, purslane, chickweed, onions, wild leeks,
and spiderwort blossoms. Chop and mix the vegetable stuffing. Spoon in the ingredients. Fold the flour in on itself. Then roll it in a whipped egg white. Place on an oiled pan and bake for 12 minutes at 325 degrees or until the flour browns. But keep an eye on it. Don't let them burn. Best over fresh salsa, garnish with nasturtiums and mustard blossoms. Use elder blueberry sauce as a dip for stuffed pumpkin blossoms. Mix a half cup of elderberries with a cup of blueberries. Simmer and mash the berries to release the juices. Strain the juice into a bowl. Add a tablespoon each of thinly sliced ginger and Dijon mustard. Splash in a tablespoon of soy and a teaspoon of lemon juice. Dip your pumpkin blossom or wonton and oishi desu, ne? A very abundant and underutilized wildflower is the Asiatic dayflower. Eat the flowers right off the plant. Anyway, Asiatic dayflowers invade gardens and waste areas. Follow the plant for a year in order to recognize it in all seasons. I collect the spring shoots, wash them, pinch off the roots, and stir fry. Add to risotto, rice, or corn dishes.
Okay, bear with me now. We're near the end. Three or four more entrees and a dessert.
Phyllo wild vegetable pie is a half day's work, but it's worth it. Ingredients include a cup each of chopped wild leeks, woodland violets, watercress, a half cup of arugula leaves and flowers, and 8 ounces of canned spinach. Chop the leeks and all the other ingredients. Then arrange the phyllo pastry as Jill demonstrates. Spray the edges with oil to prevent drying and clinging. After 5 or 6 layers, press the dough into an oil-sprayed pan. Now combine with the vegetables a half cup of cottage cheese, a quarter cup of fontanella cheese, and a quarter cup of white Mexican cheese. Here's a flavoring combo of a teaspoon of fresh rosemary and a quarter cup of fennel leaves. Then add a quarter teaspoon each of pepper, oregano, and dill. Combine the ingredients, then scoop it all into the phyllo dough. Carefully fold over the edges. If dry, soften them with a spray of oil. A handful of hickory nuts places this wild vegetable pie on the border between perfection and the wormhole to paradise.
Paradise.
I'm going to do one of my favorite things. It's not often I get to make my own pizza from scratch. Jill allows me to do this only when she's on a different continent. And in this particular case, she's in Texas, which I think is the same continent, but a different world. Anyway, this is a vegetarian wild food pizza. Here goes. So I have about five cups of flour, and I add a whole package of yeast. That's probably more yeast than you need, but yeast is good for you, lots of B vitamins. Stir that into warm water. And then enrich this dough with a sprinkling of oatmeal, actually just oats. Add some flaxseed. Next, some male reproductive parts of the cattail. I get the male reproductive parts of the cattail in June here in southern Michigan. It's the top head of the two heads of the young cattail. Strip it off and there you have it. Next, you add a splash of the yeasty water and begin making a pizza ball. When you got yourself a nice ball, you will play with it, okay? You play with it. You play with it. This helps. This helps to make a better pizza. Whoa, I got it. Let dough rise in a warm place. This is the next part. You always want to wear safety glasses. You know why? I'll show you why. Take the pizza and you're throwing it, okay? And you're throwing it and you catch it like this, and this is why you wear the glasses, see? You don't get hurt. Wild food toppings are watercress, chickweed, some wild chives, stinging nettle, and here's something new, burdock root.
If you have picked burrs, you've bumped into burdock. Burdock, Archaeum lappa, is a biennial with large fuzzy leaves. The first year's root, either harvested in the fall or spring of the year, is edible. Wash, peel, and slice the root for a dose of phytosterols and immune-stimulating polysaccharides.
So we have fennel and basil leaves here, chopped up. Stir that into the pizza sauce. Wow, what a mess. When Jill gets home, she's gonna break something vital on me. I know it. But you know what? This here pizza's worth all the pain. You gotta try this. I shouldn't talk with my mouth full, but you've got to try this. It's all over. I know. I promised you a another entree, and a dessert. But this DVD is full. So go to herbvideos.com, link to Lost Food, and you'll find stinging nettle lasagna, pawpaw chocolate cake, field berry pie, and 100 other recipes. Until the next time, take care of yourself. Let's do this again.